It is so good to have y'all here. Oh my gosh, on this wintry day here in Grand Rapids. I am so pleased that y'all have made some time to be together and worship and to join one another in this place and in this sanctuary. And it is my hope that as we do gather and worship this day, that you know that no matter who you are or where you come from or wherever you are in your journey through life, that you know that how much you are loved steadfastly and unconditionally by God, and that you are welcomed so extravagantly here at Park Church. And it is my hope that you feel the presence of the risen Christ in your midst this day. But my friends, I invite you now to bask in the glow warm of God's glory as we join together in worship this day and in beloved community, lifting up our songs, offering our prayers, and receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit as we worship this day on the fourth Sunday after Epiphany. Good friends, let us now join our hearts as one as I lift up our opening prayer and invite the Spirit of God to be amongst us this day. Loving God, open us to your Spirit as we gather in beloved community in the name of Christ Jesus, our most merciful Redeemer, friend, and brother. In this time of worship and each moment that follows, may we see Christ more clearly, love Christ more dearly, and follow Christ more nearly. Also, for the purposes of living out your vision of peace and justice, compassion and mercy, reconciliation and redemption, on earth as it is in heaven. This we pray in Christ's holy name, our rock and our redeemer, and all of God's children said, Amen. Last week, I mentioned during worship that it was a tradition for me on annual meeting Sundays to do a State of the Church address. Today, I'd like to bring forth yet another tradition that I carry with me from my 21 years of ordained pastoral ministry, and that is whenever the calendar falls on a fifth Sunday, which happens quarterly during the year, that we open up the time for someone within the congregation to share their spiritual biography and their faith journey with us. And so I am so pleased and so humbled and honored that our very first Park Church faith journey will be shared by Christian Beaufacil. So won't you please welcome and listen to Kristen's story now.
Good morning. I guess I'm the guinea pig today. all right, so I grew up on the east side of the state, and I jokingly refer to my family as being Catholic light. My family attended Mass on holidays and the few occasional Sundays, and my parents and grandparents were members of our local church. I was baptized as an infant, made my first communion, and I was confirmed in the ninth grade. I also attended Catholic school for my entire childhood education. I remember sitting in the pews of our beautiful church and walking away each service, oftentimes with more questions than answers. Fast forward to my early 20s, and when I started dating women, that I realized that my sexuality and childhood religion were conflicting. So at that point, is kind of when I stopped going to church. I resolved I was going to live my life as a spiritual or faithful person and not so much as a church person. Of all the things I learned in all those years of going was that God loved me no matter where I was seated on Sunday mornings. So fast forward to 2018. I started dating my now wife, Bridget, after years of knowing her as friends. Bridget was, unfortunately, going through a very long and contentious divorce. Her ex had relocated with their very young daughter from the Ann Arbor area, 200 miles away, to the Muskegon area. In late 2019, their divorce was finalized, and Avery was allowed to remain across the state. At that point, Bridget and I made the decision to leave our family, our friends, and our careers and moved to Grand Rapids so that Bridget could be closer to her daughter. We moved to a city where we knew no one, and 4 months later, we entered into a year of social distancing and a global pandemic. Not exactly an ideal situation to make friends and to build a community. Avery's life in West Michigan quickly started looking a lot different than when her moms were married. Her family in Muskegon had a deep-rooted faith in the Christian Reformed Church. Avery's other mom joined her family church and began attending with Avery several times a week. At age 3, Avery made her first comments to us about her developing beliefs about God and church. Her comment was that Bridget's mom, her grandma, was a bad person because she didn't attend church. If Avery believed that not going to church made you a bad person, how did she feel about us? When Avery would ask why there were so many churches near our house, we would explain about different religions and that lots of people see God and the church differently. Avery's response at age 4
was that everyone else was wrong if they didn't believe like her church. So Avery was also starting to attend a religious preschool tied to that church, so her echo chamber of beliefs was getting louder and louder. Over the years, Bridget and I started having regular conversations about how Avery's relationship with God and the church were being shaped by a very singular view. We were concerned about how her perception of her own family may change because of teachings about homosexuality and gay marriage. At that point, we decided to prioritize finding a church to take Avery just so she could understand that God loved her and her family just as they were. For me, the idea of finding a church that not only accepted who I was, but who would embrace my family and love my babies without condition felt daunting. The last thing I wanted to do was to meet well-meaning people who would indoctrinate our children in a way that made them question their parents' salvation, or even worse, their own. I was cautiously hopeful that there was a church out there that would love our family like any other and help us serve and grow in a Christian community. A few days after that conversation, Bridget and I were scrolling on social media and happened to come across a post on our Rockford community Facebook page. It read, "I am wondering if there are any churches in the Rockford area that are truly warm, welcoming, and open to all people, regardless of age, race, sexual orientation, or immigration status. Looking for a community that is non-judgmental, supportive, and has a strong program for children. I have a son who is gay, and if we explore going back to church, it will need to be a congregation that accepts him with love. This would be the first step back after a long absence from regular attendance. Thanks." Kind of ironic. Within an hour, there were over 100 comments. There were people recommending dozens of churches with lots of responses that most of these churches, while welcoming, were not affirming and would not treat the LGBTQ members with the same privileges as others. For example, they wouldn't marry this woman's gay son. Park Church was recommended by a handful of folks, and all of the comments supported that it was truly a place for everyone. So we decided to give it a try. We started attending when services were still only virtual, and once things reopened in 2021, we began attending with Avery in person. For the first time, without understanding why or what the significance was, Avery heard messages of not just loving, but loving, honoring, and serving all people. She met other families that look like ours. I look back on the last 4 years, and I have to laugh a little bit. For my story, I'm sure you're thinking that we're only here for my stepdaughter. While that might have been the catalyst, I truly believe that Avery was God's way of inviting us back to his table. It was his way of saying, "Let me give you an opportunity to find a community that will allow you to celebrate, pray, learn, grow, and serve exactly as you are." And for that, we're so grateful.
Thank you, Kristen, for such a brave and courageous time of sharing your life and your story with us. We are so, so grateful for you and so glad that your family has found a home here at Park Church. Your story impacts us in such a great way. It helps us to recognize why what we do is important and why you are important, and that why everyone is so loved here. My friends, let us now go to God in a time of prayer. I invite you to quiet your mind and your hearts and to open your spirits to receive that which God would give and say to us this day. Bring your joys, bring your concerns. Offer up your celebrations and your triumphs. And lean into the hope of God as we express our laments and our trials and tribulations. Let us go now to God in a word of prayer. God of all goodness, by glimpsing something of your vision of a merciful and just world, we become acutely aware of how much inhumanity and suffering still exists in the world. And it would overwhelm us if it were not for the tender beauty and hope that arises each morning and shimmers from the heavens at night. And so it is with a spirit of gratitude and wonder that we lift up our prayers for the healing of our suffering world. We hold in our hearts this day those who are ailing of body, mind, and spirit. We pray for Lloyd and Steve, Judy and Bev, Ruth and Dave, Christine and Bill, and all who are in our lives and in our community in need of your healing mercies. We pray for those who grieve and mourn this day. We pray for the Casey family, the Lovell family, the Heydrich family. And on this, the 2-year anniversary of the death of Dieter Schrapers, we are so pleased that his soul is at peace, resting beside those still waters of paradise. And we pray that you would mend the heart of Carolyn as she continues to walk through the journey of grief and lean into the joy of remembering her loved ones and life and their life together. Be with her and all who mourn the loss of loved ones this day. May they know your presence and be comforted by your abiding love. And we pray for all who are suffering from all the senseless ways we do violence to one another. From the violence of police brutality to gun violence and mass shootings. From the violence of terror attacks and war to the violence of racism, anti-Semitism, homophobia, and xenophobia. We are weary, O God, sometimes close to despair by the ways that we treat each other, dehumanize each other. And in these times, sometimes all we can do is pray. So we pray for the family of Tyree Nichols and the people of Memphis. We pray that justice will be done with transparency and reform. We pray for our Asian American Pacific Islander neighbors and friends who live in fear yet again due to the violence against them. We pray for the people of Half Moon Bay and Monterey Park. We pray for the queer community and their safety and the overturning of laws and statutes that would deny them their full personhood. We pray for the unhoused and those without a safe place to rest, those who go to bed hungry and thirsty. We pray for an end of the war in Ukraine, for peace in Israel and Palestine. We pray for the women and girls of Iran who are fighting for their human rights. We pray all of this, along with the meditations of our hearts, with the faith of Christ Jesus, whose own Good Friday crucifixion shows us that violence, suffering, and despair, the deaths and sufferings of your children, will not be in vain. For by the power of your redemptive grace and eternal love, we can overcome evil and live into your Easter vision. It is with his faith and in his name that we come to you in prayer this day. For he is our rock and our redeemer, and he taught us to bring everything to you in prayer when he taught us these ancient and sacred words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Our scripture reading for today is found in the prophecy of Micah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Listen for the word of God for you this day. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the case of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a case against God's people, and God will contend with them. God replies, O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Micah responds, With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before the Lord with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? God has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Here ends our reading, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may or may not know this about me, but I kind of think of myself as a nerd. And so whenever something fun, nerdy, scientific kind of comes across my screen, I will often click on it. And I remember a few years ago, a very famous experiment that I read about that measured whether or not our closest primate relative, the bonobo, had any level of understanding of ethics and morality. Did anyone else read this study? All right, so I'm the only nerd. All right, I get it. To test this hypothesis, two bonobos from the same clan were asked to hand over a rock from their enclosure very gently to a scientist. And if they handed over the rock, then they would be given a cucumber. Now, a cucumber may not sound like much of a reward to us, but trust me, to the bonobo, they were quite content to receive a cucumber for compensation for their work. Then, after a little while, the scientists switched things up. And the first bonobo did the task, and it was given a cucumber. But then the second bonobo completed the task, and its reward was a grape. And trust me, a grape was a huge pay increase. And the first bonobo saw this. And so the first bonobo did the task again, received a cucumber, but it didn't eat the cucumber. It just held the cucumber in its grubby little bonobo paw. And when the second bonobo handed over the rock yet again and was given the grape, well, let me just say that first bonobo literally went ape caca. It protested that injustice, throwing the cucumber at the scientist and started rattling the cage. This was repeated a few more times. The first bonobo did the work, got a cucumber. Second bonobo did the exact same work, got a grape. The first bonobo throws the cucumber in protest and then makes a good old ruckus. But then something very fascinating happened after a while. The second bonobo changed its behavior. The second bonobo began to refuse to eat the grape it had been given. It started to advocate for its kindred in the form of a hunger strike. It would not eat its grape until the other bonobo started to receive a grape as well. Basically, what the scientists observed in this experiment was that this was the bonobo version of Occupy Wall Street. It was like the bonobo had read Gandhi and was doing a nonviolent resistance, exposing the injustice of the system. And another way of looking at it maybe was that the bonobos were doing justice and loving mercy. And so the scientists concluded that our closest primate cousins do understand justice and fairness. And come to find out, there's a whole swath of God's creatures that are more communitarian in their approach to life that seem to know these moral traits. Animals who organize and build complex networks of community and mutuality seem to be almost infused with a spirit of morality. They exhibit time and time and time and time again the principles of justice and fairness, compassion and mercy, advocacy and solidarity. They make these moral principles part of their daily living. Now I know I'm a nerd, so I know it's bad science to anthropomorphize animals too far. But I'm also a Christian preacher and theologian, so it's not hard for me to spiritually imagine that when God blessed the creation as good, God's spirit of justice, compassion, and advocacy were granted to our non-human neighbor. For it seems that our non-human kindred seem to have an intrinsic understanding of the morals of the pillars of morality, and that they will practice out these virtues of morality within the context of their communities and their kindred relationships. Maybe it is, as Saint Bernard of Clairvaux once wrote, that there is a wisdom that the trees and the animals can teach us that are not contained in any book. And perhaps it's this creative moral wisdom that seems to permeate throughout all of creation and nature is why the prophet Micah seats the creation as the jury in his courtroom drama. That's right. The entire book of the prophecy of Micah is basically produced by Dick Wolf. Think of the prophecy of Micah as Law and Order, the Jerusalem unit, circa 700 BCE. Let me set this courtroom drama up for you. In Micah's day, in Israel, the king and the king's court, the military leadership and the religious clergy, those in power seemed so corrupt and much more concerned with their own fame and fortune than improving the standard of living of the ordinary citizenry, not to mention having the time or the wherewithal to take care of the poor, the widow, or the orphan. And the king and his nobles and those in his court exploited their relationship with the temple, the religion of their day, to ease their conscience. They did this by giving large sums of money. I'm talking obscene amount of money to renovate the temple of Solomon. And in Micah's opinion, the king and his cohort felt that their monetary tithe let them off the hook for their immoral behavior. It's as if the king and his court said, we can raise Cain Saturday through Thursday as long as we find ourselves in temple on Friday. A temple which they paid for, by the way. And the poor? Well, they were exploited. They did all the heavy, dangerous, back-breaking labor, and they basically got bupkis for their work. There was no minimum wage, let alone a livable wage in ancient Israel. In other words, the workers got a cucumber if they were lucky, while the king and his cohort and all of his cronies in the temple and in the military got grapes. All the grapes. And so Micah exposes this hypocrisy. He saw how this system was rigged against the poor, and the prophet intervened to help get his society and culture and nation back on the right path. Micah saw that the pillars of morality were crumbling in his society, and he feared that ancient Israel was teetering on collapsing. And so to get this message across to the people in a way that they could understand, Micah imagines them, invites them into a divine courtroom drama. And in this courtroom drama, the plaintiff is God, bringing a lawsuit against the people of God. And in the jury box is the creation, all of nature. And God lays out God's case, presenting this evidence. I created you, God said, liberated you and set you free. I saved you time and time again in the wilderness. I brought you to the land overflowing with milk and honey. I made a covenant to be your God always, and you agreed to this covenant. You would agree to keep your half of the covenant by following my will, being a fair and righteous people, reflecting my glory, my peace, my grace. So why then do you continually go against my will? Perpetuate injustice, unfairly exploit the poor, show no compassion for the widow, the orphan, desecrate my creation and reject the refugee. God says, I have kept my end of the covenant, but you break your half over and over and over again. Why? Humanity recognizes they are in trouble. They are losing the court case. So they do what? They try to make a plea bargain. And this is the plea bargain that humanity tries to make with God. We, the people, offer to worship you, God, even more, bringing even more and more offerings to the temple. We'll come with whole burnt offerings, year-old calves. Will God be happy with thousands of rams? What about 10,000 rivers of oil? Is that not enough? If that isn't enough, then God will give you the firstborn of our lives. This ridiculous plea is so far off the mark. Screaming young calves and hordes of ram, rivers of expensive oil, and human sacrifice are not what God wants from us at all. It's even more ridiculous when you know that these things were already being done. So basically, the plea bargain that the people make with God is the status quo. Can we just keep things the way they are? And to no surprise, God rejects the plea deal. God essentially says to the people, you're not buying or talking your way out of this. What God really wants is found in the infamous verse of Micah 6:8. O mortal, what does the Lord your God require of you? Do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. These three, nothing more, nothing less. Do justice. The Hebrew word here for justice is mishpat. And mishpat means to de-rig the system so that everyone has equal access to the goods and services of society. A word that might be better translated into English from the Hebrew mishpat might be equity. So Micah tells the people, get on your knees and pray to God and then get up and get to work re-rigging the system and creating new ones that enfranchise people. Make sure that no one is exploited. And we are not allowed to stay neutral in the face of injustice, even if we don't feel the injustice ourselves. For as the late Archbishop Desmond Tutu once reminded us, if you are neutral in the situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. If an elephant has its foot on the tail of a mouse and you say to the mouse, I am going to remain neutral, the mouse will not appreciate your neutrality. You must love hesed. The Hebrew here word hesed is almost untranslatable into English, but I'll do my best. It means the unbreakable love of God that God has for all creation. It's a love that emanates from the very heart of God. It gets translated into Greek as agape. It's that deep, powerful, mature kind of love. It's a sacrificial love, willing to suffer for the sake of an other so that all may be redeemed. You must do that, Micah says, because on the divine love, all of our lives rest. And lastly, Leket Im Elohim, which usually gets translated into English as walk humbly with your God. But I think that's actually a bit too sentimental for us. In fact, the word usually translated as the humble, I think, is a better translation and more accurately seen as steadfastly or continually. And it's more than just a leisurely stroll in the park. It's a trek. It's a journey. It's a sojourn to liberate us from our sins and violent tendencies. It is a lifelong journey that begins with the cradle and ends in the grave, that we are continuously and steadfastly to be on with God. And when we find ourselves out of step with God and we make the necessary corrections, then we can step back onto the righteous path. And what is humanity's response to God's counteroffer? If you read the very next verse after Micah 6:8, which is Micah 7:1, our answer is, we're doomed. We're doomed. Doing justice, loving mercy, walking humbly, that's impossible. There's no way we can or will do those things. But my friends, our attempts to appease God with a plea deal so that the status quo may remain, it has been roundly rejected. And in its place, we hear what God truly wants from us. Do equity. Make it so that no one gets a cucumber when they ought to get a grape. And make sure no one or no group of people hoard all the grapes for themselves. Love mercy. Do this essential, holy, sacred work of equity out of the recognition of God's unshakable love for you. And walk continuously with God, rejecting the woe is me-isms of our ancestors, and get yourself back on the righteous path. Now I know that many of us come into church this morning weary after reading and viewing how Tyre Nichols was brutally murdered by the Memphis police. The very people who were called, whose very vocation it was to serve and protect this young man. I know many of us are weary after so many examples and so many times that there have been school shootings or mass gun violence or terror attacks. I know many of us are scared this day because we are LGBTQ and there are laws being passed in this country denying us our full humanity. We are weary every time another study comes out that there's a mass extinction of species and our climate and our planet is warming too fast. But I say to you this day, my friends, unlike our ancestors, do not feel doomed. We may have been convicted in Micah's court, but we have been given another chance through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ Jesus. Do not let your weariness override your hope this day. Do not forfeit. Do not allow doom and despair to claim the day, but lean into hope. The hope that God can make a way out of no way and can turn every heavy shadow of Good Friday's cross into the bright glory of Easter's. We name our lament. We say how this society has allowed evil to exist, but we do not give in to fear and we will not be dismayed. We will trust that the sun will rise again. Evil will not have the last word. Love will. Even as our hearts break and our souls weep, let me say unto you, have hope still this day. Not a naive hope, but a hope enlivened out of the very heart of God. and trust that God's vision of a redeemed world can happen, will happen. By God's grace and with God's help, we can rebuild our society on the pillars of morality, and we can live according to God's will for our lives. We have a simple equation to follow. God has told us what is required of us: equity, mercy, journeying continually with God. And if you need any proof that these three things can be done, may we look no further than our closest primate cousins and trust that by God's grace and with the help of God, we can do justice, mercy, and walk continually just like they do. For if they can do it, and if they can rebuild their societies and communities on the pillars of morality, I, for one, don't see any reason why we can't either. And that's the good news this day. Amen and amen.
Join me in our prayer of dedication. Gracious and compassionate God, we offer ourselves to you again in worship, in listening, and in giving, in lives committed to the purposes and practices of your love and grace. We give of what we have, for in this way we know we are blessed to be a blessing to humankind. Amen.
Amen.
My friends, as our worship comes to a close on this, the fourth Sunday after Epiphany, I want to say thank you to Kristen yet again for sharing her spiritual biography and faith journey with us. I want to thank the Chancel Choir and the Choral Scholars for their music, and it is my hope that as we leave this place, that your hearts have been lifted and your spirits have been filled, and you have been inspired to do equity, to love mercy, and to walk continuously with our God. Let us do so as we lift up and we live out the words of our common commission. Let us now go forth into the world in peace, being of good courage, holding fast to that which is good, rendering to no one evil for evil, strengthening the faint-hearted, supporting the weak, helping the afflicted, honoring all people, loving and serving the Lord, and rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.